My name is Leeroy, and I'm going to talk about how my practice is grounded on this idea of collaboration. But I guess I need to give you guys a brief introduction as to my creative beginnings. The image that you are seeing right now is pretty much the kind of art that I was exposed to as a kid, no? Back in General Santos City, I didn't really have access to contemporary art-making practices. You know, this is kind of what I would see being peddled in the streets. These images would usually depict, like, farmlands, farmers toiling in the fields, you know, fishermen, flowers, and fruits. And as a kid, these were the kinds of works that I wanted to do. And I did. This was, like, back in 1994. I was a big fan of vegetables. And at the same time, you know, I would draw like pages and pages of monsters. I tried to reconcile the two different concepts, but I couldn't. So I chose to do more, I guess, alien stuff or like monster stuff. So after General Santos City, I got accepted to the Philippine High School for the Arts. This pretty much determined how I would approach art making in the future. I kind of basically studied with artists from different industries, like performance, dance, and ballet, and theater under performance arts, and music as well. We'd work with writers, and as a visual artist, we would end up doing their props, their sets. So it was a very holistic way of approaching creativity. So this was pretty much the landscape of the school that I studied in. We were left alone on a mountain, and we pretty much did a lot of things on our own. And we'd go into the mountains, and there were like 100 trails, and we were just free to actually explore the mountain on our own. Illegally, of course. Being plucked from the province and placed on this art school up north, it was pretty much a culture shock for me. Everything was new. I mean, it was the first time I encountered like guys with long hair or like agnostics. So, and these were the kind of works that my mentors did back then. These are like clear plastic slippers impaled using bamboo poles, baby sweaters transformed into vaginas. So these were the kind of stuff that my professors did, like interactive large-scale sculptures. This professor of mine did like sawdust sculptures. Something that really struck me back then was something that my professor said before we had this adapted concept of art. Pre-colonial culture did not even separate the two things, no? Like art and life. Art was wholly integrated into our daily rituals. Before we were painters and sculptors, we were weavers, potters, and carvers, my professor would tell me. So that kind of stuck with me, and I felt I needed to come up with like specific art-making practices that fit our cultural context. So I would make my own versions of these sacred spaces, and they would be interactive. They were meant to be experienced and felt, and you would get a sense of your own physicality in relation to the structures or the sculptures that I had positioned in a specific site. So these were attempts to approximate sacred spaces. These are paper sculptures that I did like after graduating high school. So these were attempts to actually replicate caves as sacred spaces. So when I got into UP Diliman, that was the time when there was this proliferation of MMDA art. Me and my classmate in fine arts, decided that we needed to actually
go out and do our own version of street art. So we managed to paint all over UP, and we decided to put on fake MMDA uniforms and paint in the streets as well. So back then, we were like approaching in several galleries to show our works, but I guess, you know, it made sense that they would like not accept us because we were young and we were impatient. But that didn't really hinder us from, you know, creating the conditions to present our works. So, you know, we just came up with alternative avenues or like platforms to present our, you know, artistic intentions. So next is a series of photos, which I've arranged to give you an idea of how I would branch out into different contexts and applications of a particular form. Like for this, for example, is from the drip series. I guess there was this point in my student life that I was fascinated by dripping forms. And I would always try to maximize a particular form. So after doing like wall pieces, how can I maximize this idea further? Why not create sculpture installations where the viewer can actually experience in real time and in actual space the objects that you create? And after that, I thought that maybe I can apply that form architecturally. So a friend of mine asked me to design the facade of his store and for like very minimum costs. And I said yes, because I was like a fresh graduate. And every opportunity I could get to do like work outside in the streets, I would. So this was my thesis project back in UP. When you do site-specific works, it's not merely a negotiation with the physical space. I had to like go through admin. I had to like get national artist Napoleon Abueva's approval, or like I had to get him to sign, you know, a permission letter and a letter of agreement that allowing me to actually intervene on his work. If you're familiar with this piece, these are those two paper airplane-like structures that greet you as you enter UP Diliman, which was designed by national artist Napoleon Abueva. So once I got his go signal, everything went smoothly, but I had to like negotiate with the community involved in safeguarding these structures. So after college, I worked with a lot of filmmakers. Film was one of the things that I really wanted to get into. As a kid, I was watching special effects shows where they would expose the inner workings of prosthetics, like how they do like special scenes and with mock-ups and scale models. It was all part of this desire to create and transform worlds. So these were one of the things that we did back in high school. So it made sense that I would explore the human body when I wanted to expand the idea of the drippings. So of course, I'd have a lot of these prototypes lying around in the studio. We'd just end up shooting them. And I'd explore like different materials, and I'd encounter like different qualities for these different kinds of silicone and create like these temporary body human configurations. So it seemed like so natural for me to involve the human body, since I've worked with performers. Most of them would agree to my, you know, requests. And after doing it on a human scale, again, I would like think of how to actually use this technique on a larger context, like on a larger scale, like architecturally. This is the interior of the CCP, and we applied latex on the walls of the structure, and we stretched the latex outwards to create these organic configurations. And again, you had to go through all these in-house architects, in-house engineers, like the visual arts department. So it's not just about manipulating space and the matter and the material. It's also about manipulating all these egos and emotions involved when putting up a work. So after that, how else can I push this idea of the stretched latex? I would collaborate with performers, and they would do their own configurations using their own bodies. So the dripping form evolved into the blob form. I was invited to do like a site-specific installation for the Singapore Biennale. The blob form evolved into a creature spaceship of some sort. I approach material in the same way that I do, you know, everything else. Like I would just walk in Divisoria and try to expose myself to as many things as possible. And these random encounters usually end up becoming entire series of works, like the cable ties. It's how you just respond to what is available. It was there, it was cheap. I immediately thought, why not weave them together and create like these wearable pieces? So after doing like headpiece and a vest and a full bodysuit, what's next? Like inject color into the mix, like create environments out of them, inject like new materials into the technique. So during one of my residencies, I encountered like piles of discarded hoses and decided to just play with it. Weave it with zip ties, and I ended up producing something that resembled the Balete 3 for me. So I just went ahead and explored the technique even further. So in a sense, you kind of harness the structure of the space and the community that use the space in their like a daily routine. And for this particular piece, I intentionally wanted to scatter the tentacles on the floor so that, you know, to sort of disrupt the routine of the students that were studying in Ateneo. And I would see like these photos being uploaded on the internet. So the Balete is basically this parasitic plant that would wrap itself around an existing tree and eventually consume the tree and, you know, outgrow the tree. And the original tree would, you know, deteriorate and you'd end up like having cavities inside the Balete tree. So it's pretty much the inspiration for this wrapping around existing structures. So my inclination towards filmmaking and theater contributed a lot greatly to my preference for creating environments. And with environments, I would also do like the creatures that inhabited it, you know, different plant life maybe. Again, I would ask for volunteers from my friends, and we'd just like experiment on reconfiguring these existing techniques. So the technique would evolve. We'd try to maximize like context and how to apply it. And these constant collaborators of mine, the Sipatlawin and Sam, they do site-specific performances, and I always provide them with you know, whatever they need. So of course I'd have like a pile of these things lying around in the studio, and again, you know, I would tap my photographer friends and we just end up shooting like these different scenarios. So working in the theater, you realize that you are just a part of the entire production. None of that romanticized artist ego here. It's like there's a bigger vision that needs to be served. So that's one thing that working in the film productions and the theater has taught me, and it, you know, it keeps you grounded. So this is like another series where I encountered like these assorted toys in Divisoria, and again we would do like costumes out of them. These are the tops of those little toys, and these are stackable like a local type of Lego. So the toy series and the Balete series kind of gave birth to this. The Balete eventually had blooms and blossoms and flowers and fruit. Just so I could appease my performance artist friends, I decided to subject myself to the same, you know, experiments that I would subject them to. So for this particular work, I poured expanding foam over my own body before I did it to them. So I realized that, you know, creating wearable pieces, you know, it's not enough that they be modeled or they be put on mannequins. It's important for me that they be performed by people who can actually move their bodies. And that's something that I find value in when I work with these people. So this is another level of collaboration, I think. I've worked with manufacturing companies, different techniques and specialties, and for this particular company, they do fine welding. I've worked with shoe companies. So it's completely counterintuitive to what art making is for me. Because when you do product design, it's like you have to constantly edit yourself, and you have to consider costs, technical concerns like manufacturing and dissemination. For this particular project, I was asked to work with the local government of Ilocos Norte to activate the Pawai sand dunes. So they kind of modeled it after the Burning Man festival. So it's basically this barren wasteland. There's no hope for agriculture or like any permanent structure because the sand is unstable. Aside from pushing for the 4x4s and the ATVs, why not capitalize on or like harness this, the cultural capital of the site. It has been the site for like many popular local films, as well as like the original Mad Max film was shot here as well, I think. So they asked me to go there like for a month to build that bamboo structure. I decided to maximize my stay there by asking them if they could donate all their junk from their engineering compound. So they obliged and they allowed me to use like discarded water tanks, cement fountains, their junk jeeps, spiral staircases. So I think it's a good model for how art and design can be harnessed to provide like innovations on urban development and regional development. So aside from that, aside from actually using physical and actual space, we've decided to explore the digital realm as well, no? By putting up this project of ours called Aliens of Manila. So we would shoot our performance artist collaborators in the different streets, in different scenarios, real life scenarios, but with all this alien artifice. And the plan is to eventually crowdsource aliens from the community, and we will be inviting people to submit their own alien scenarios. So eventually the account can be like a crowdsource gallery for everyone who wants to be involved in the project. This is an ongoing project that we have. It's this floating island that we wanna move across the length of the Pasig River. It serves as a performance space. This is like 50% progress on the island. Eventually it's going to be like filled with plants and more sculptural forms. It'll dock itself in different areas of the Pasig River. It can be the site for like performances, outdoor public performances or workshops. Eventually, we plan to do more of these and scatter them across the length of the river. It's one way to harness the creative potential of the site, no? Because it's all just concrete lining the river and nothing else. So there's actually a video. So this is another project that I have with my collaborator, who's a chair for the Inclusive Mobility Network. And so we decided to do like bike mascots for like parades. To raise awareness for, you know, the inclusive mobility cause. This is a little teaser we did for the Pasig River Floating Islands project. So we tried to test how effective it would be as a performance space. Also, working with like 7 government agencies, we had to like go through different tests. Like, we tried it out because the Coast Guards wanted to check if it actually you know, would float. So the long-term plan is to actually come up with this river design and art festival. So, yeah, thank you.